Hey, this is John with nrsng.com. Today, we're going to talk about what preload and afterload are. So, to best understand preload and afterload, we have to know where those numbers are coming from first. So, to understand that, we start with stroke volume. So, what is stroke volume? Stroke volume essentially is how much blood is being ejected from the heart with each beat. So that number normally should be 60 to 120 mils per beat. So that's about how much blood is being ejected from the heart with each beat. And there's three things that make up stroke volume. So first of all, the first thing that makes up stroke volume is contractility. Okay. So contractility, we understand, is basically the force with which the heart is beating. So that's going to be our contractility. The two other things that make up our stroke volume is going to be preload and, of course, afterload. Okay, so we have our contractility, preload, and afterload. Those three things are going to determine how much blood is being ejected from the heart with each beat. Okay, so with those three things in mind, then we have to differentiate between what is preload and what is afterload. Okay, so over here we'll put preload, and over here we'll put afterload. Okay, so let's start initially with preload. Okay, so what is preload? To best understand preload, we need to kind of think of preload as a volume. Okay, preload is essentially the volume of blood that is sitting in the ventricles at the end of diastole. Okay, so it is really our end diastolic volume. So preload is end diastolic volume. It's the volume of blood sitting within the ventricles at the end of diastole. Okay, and there's two ways to kind of measure that. We can measure that with our CVP, and that's going to be our right ventricle. And we can measure that with our pulmonary artery occlusion pressure. And that number is going to give us essentially our left ventricular end diastolic volume, which we can determine as our preload. Okay, so preload, we have our heart. Preload is going to be the volume of blood in the ventricles at the end of diastole. So after these ventricles are filled, preload is the amount of blood in there at the end of diastole, and that is measured as a pressure, millimeters of mercury. Okay, so the CVP and pulmonary occlusion pressure are going to kind of give us that end diastolic volume of the right ventricle, left ventricle, and that is going to equate to our preload. So preload is the volume of blood in the ventricles at the end of diastole, and it's measured as a pressure. Okay? So afterload. What is afterload? Afterload, it helps me to think of afterload as a pressure. Okay? So afterload is essentially the pressure that is required to open the valves at the beginning of systole. So at the beginning of systole, we're trying to open our aortic and our pulmonic valves to eject the blood out of the heart, either to the body or to the lungs. And afterload is the pressure required to actually open those valves. Okay, so again, here's our heart. And we have our aortic valve that is going to eject blood out to the system, to the body. And we have our pulmonic valve that's going to eject blood out to the lungs. Okay, so these valves are closed due to the pressure of the vessels. In order to open those valves, a certain pressure is going to be required to actually open those valves and eject the blood out. That pressure is our afterload. So we have all of our blood sitting here in our ventricle, and we have to get that blood out of the ventricles and into either the body or to the lungs. In order to open those vessels, those valves, and actually get the blood into those vessels, we need a certain pressure. That pressure is our afterload. Okay, and we can use two different number or two different values to kind of determine what our afterload is. We can use PVR and SVR. PVR is pulmonary vascular resistance. SVR is systemic vascular resistance. So PVR is pulmonary vascular resistance. That is the resistance that these pulmonary vessels are exerting against this valve. That's the pressure that the right ventricle is going to have to work against to get blood to the lungs. Okay, and SVR is systemic vascular resistance. That's the pressure that the aorta is exerting back onto the left ventricle, and it's the pressure against which the left ventricle is going to have to pump in order to open the aortic valve. Okay, so that's essentially the difference between preload and afterload. Preload is our volume. It's going to be the end diastolic volume. It's the volume sitting in the ventricles at the end of diastole. Once the ventricles are filled, it's the pressure in there, inside the ventricles. Afterload is going to be the pressure against which the ventricles are going to have to pump in order to get blood out of the heart. Alright, so with that in mind, what are going to be some things that we can... So we have preload. Preload, which is our end diastolic volume, the volume within the heart at the end of diastole. So what are some things that are going to increase our preload? Essentially, things that are going to increase our preload are going to be basically it's a volume status issue, essentially, for the most part. So reasons that we might have a decreased preload is going to be hypotension, hypovolemia, things that are keeping the ventricles from filling. So in the case of a decreased preload, we can do some things to increase our preload. So if we want to increase preload, so we're trying to increase preload. So we have a low preload, and we want to get our preload up. We can give things like fluids, blood, and things like that to try to get more blood into our ventricles to increase our end diastolic volume. So, and in the case of trying to decrease preload, so if we're trying to decrease our preload, so in the case of having a low preload or a high preload, so heart failure might result in high preload. We have volume sitting there that we aren't able to get rid of. So in order to decrease our preload, we might give diuretics. To try to decrease it, we might give ACE inhibitors to try to decrease that preload, okay? So to try to decrease the amount of fluid that's actually within our ventricles at the end of diastole, we can give diuretics or ACE inhibitors, for example, among other things. Okay, so now we have afterload. Let's say, so afterload we've discussed as either our PVR or our SVR. So it's the resistance that the vessels are exerting, and it's the pressure that our ventricles are going to have to push in order to open those valves and get blood either to the lungs or to the systemic vasculature. So what is something that might increase our SVR? So things that might increase our afterload are going to be things that are going to increase our SVR. So it's going to be like a high blood pressure. It's going to be states where we have increased vasoconstriction. Okay, so in order to decrease that vasoconstriction, so we want to decrease our afterload. So in the case of increased afterload, it's going to be increased systemic vascular resistance or pulmonary vascular resistance. We're going to want to actually decrease that afterload. So we'll want to give things like vasodilators. Okay. We want to give things like ACE inhibitors to try to decrease that afterload. Another therapy is an intra-aortic balloon pump. So what the intra-aortic balloon pump is going to do is at the beginning of systole, the intra-aortic balloon pump is actually going to deflate, and that deflation is going to actually pull blood forward into the system, which is going to help to decrease our SVR. So in the case of a decreased systemic vascular resistance. So we're trying to increase our afterload. So essentially what a decreased afterload is essentially saying is it's saying we have vasodilation. So we have extremely dilated vessels, and so that might result in like a hypotension, or this might be in the case of like a septic shock or a vasogenic shock, where we have extreme vasodilation and our blood pressures are dropping and things. So with a decreased afterload, we're looking at decreased systemic vascular resistance, most likely a hypotension and severe vasodilation. So things that we might give for this are going to be like vasopressors. And some of the things that might be given are like levofed, phenylephrine, vasopressin or epinephrine, things like that that are going to actually increase our vasoconstriction. So we're going to vasoconstrict, and that's going to result in increased afterload. Okay, so that's kind of just a basic introduction to preload and afterload. This is John with nrsng.com. Please visit us at nrsng.com, and you can go to our about page to view information about us and our full medical disclaimer. We appreciate you listening, and we hope to see you back with us.